Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It is an honor and privilege to welcome on behalf of the President of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, Professor Pavla Šajgalíka, here at the Hall of Mirrors, Prime Minister Palace, for the award ceremony of the International Prize of the Slovak Academy of Sciences. This year, two prizes will be awarded, the 2021 Prize in Technical Sciences and the 2022 Prize in Natural Sciences. My name is Tomáš Komárka. I here represent the Academy, and I also will be your guide during the ceremony. I am especially grateful that I can welcome our distinguished guests here. Professor and Mrs. YangQuan Chen from the University of California, Merced, Professor Michel Salzet and Professor Isabel Fournier from the University of Lille, His Excellency Pascal Ledunf, the Ambassador of France, His Excellency Makoto Nakagawa, the Ambassador of Japan, Professor Vladimir Šuka, Head of European Commission Representation in Slovakia, Dr. Ludovic Paulis, State Secretary of the Ministry of Education, Science, Research and Sport of the Slovak Republic, Petr Sika, State Secretary of the Office of the Deputy Prime Minister of the Slovak Republic, distinguished representatives of Slovak universities, Professor Ferenc Hudec, Vice President for Natural Sciences of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences, academician Vladislav Mako and Professor Štefan Lubi, former presidents of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, members of the Assembly of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, members of the Scientific Council of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, members of the Presidium of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, members of the Council of Directors of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, members of the Learned Society of Slovakia. Ladies and gentlemen, in this very room, in 1805, after the Battle of Austerlitz, the so-called Peace of Pressburg was signed. One of the consequences, and the historians in the room will forgive me, was also the dissolution of the Holy Roman Empire, which existed for 1,000 years. And consequently, the Holy Roman Emperor Francis II became Francis I, the Emperor of Austria. And you might have noticed this magnificent Roman-style bust at the staircase when you enter the building. I mean, all of this is obviously completely unrelated to our ceremony. Right. But this is a hall of historical significance. And today we just hope to add a bit more of that significance by celebrating exceptional scientific achievements of two outstanding scholars who will be awarded the International Prize of the Slovak Academy of Sciences. Now let us begin the award ceremony itself with music. We are fortunate to have with us today the Mucha Quartet, who will now perform the string quartet in G major, part one allegro by Fritz Kaffender. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Mucha Quartet.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the magnificent performance. I can see on the faces of many of you that you also enjoyed the performance. Now let's proceed with the ceremony. Having received the nomination from the Technical University in Košice, the Scientific Council of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, in recognition of outstanding work related to Slovakia, awards the 2021 International Prize of the Slovak Academy of Sciences and Technical Sciences to Professor YangQuan Chen from the University of California at Merced. Now I would like to ask Professor Pepe Samoli to deliver the laudation for Professor YangQuan Chen. Dear Professor YangQuan Chen, dear Professor Salzet, Excellencies, Ambassador of the Republic of France, Ambassador of Emperor of Japan, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. President, our President of the Academy of Sciences. Today, Professor YangQuan Chen receives an international award of the Slovak Academy of Sciences for the year 2021. In the field of engineering or technical sciences for his outstanding high-impact research in such a field as modeling and control of processes, automation, mechatronics, robotics, UAV, which stands for unmanned autonomous vehicles, very popular, signal processing, elasticity, energy, and many others. The common foundation to this research is the use of modern mathematical methods, especially the theory of integration and differentiation of arbitrary real order, known as fractional order calculus. I make a small detour and remind you that the calculus of derivatives and integrals has been one of the most important scientific inventions in human history, made by two giants, Newton and Leibniz. But unfortunately, there was a very long controversy between these two gentlemen on the question who was the first to invent this famous invention. And in this long-standing argumentation, not only between these two gentlemen, but also other big persons took place, because Gottfried von Leibniz first mentioned the calculus of fractional integrals and derivatives 300 years ago. But it took quite some time. But finally, also thanks to people like our today recipient, the fractional calculus became a strong tool describing anomalous processes in many systems, as I mentioned before. Actually, this is not the first prize or first award which Slovak Academy of Sciences is giving to some distinguished person dealing with fractional calculus. We had the privilege a few years ago also to have a very nice meeting with Professor Klafter, president of the Tel Aviv University, also an expert in this very distinguished field. But let's continue first with a short curriculum vitae of our distinguished Professor YangQuan Chen, who is a full professor of mechatronics at the University of California in Merced, U.S., and the head of the MESALAB Mechatronics Embedded Systems and Automation Laboratory. He studied industrial automation at the University of Science and Technology in Beijing and received his baccalaureate degree in 1985, followed by master's degree in 1989. Then he continued his education in Nanyang Technological University, Singapore, where he obtained a PhD degree in 1998. His teaching and research in Xi'an Technological University took him to the position of the deputy head of the Department of Electrical Engineering, but later he moved to Singapore for working as a researcher at the National University of Singapore, and then to the Seagate Corporation, where he worked on the controllers of hard disk drives and for the first handler about non-integer order controller. In the year 2000, he moved to the US and for 12 years worked at the Utah State University, where he successfully headed the Center of Self-Organizing and Intelligent Systems
In 2012, he moved to the University of California in Merced, and after only several years, he received there the Academic Senate Distinguished Research Award for 2 years. Professor YangQuan Chen made his significant contribution to the development of the theory and application of process control using fractional order integration and differentiation and fractional order controllers. His research collaboration with the Slovak colleagues led by academicians of the Learned Society of Slovakia, Professor Podlubny and Professor Petras, has more than 20 years history and started in the year 2000. Their fruitful collaboration resulted in many joint publications, software tools, joint organization of international conferences, co-editing of special issues of top journals, exchange of doctoral students and researchers, and in other joint activities. Professor Chen collaborated as a foreign member on projects supported by the Slovak grant agencies, and also on the first European COST project devoted to fractional border modeling and control. In collaboration with the Slovak colleagues, Professor Chen did very important work on preparing, introducing, and teaching new courses. Such courses as fractional differential equations and applications, fractional order control, fractional order mechanics, became standard parts of study programs at many universities in the US, Germany, Spain, UK, Italy, Belgium, Poland, Estonia, and other countries, including, of course, Slovakia. He supported his research and teaching activity by 16 research monographs and 5 textbooks published by the respectable publisher. His excellent textbooks on process control and automation with the use of MATLAB are used for teaching such courses also at the Technical University Košice in Slovakia. For 4 years in a row, namely from Professor Chen, is included in the list of highly cited researchers published by Clarivate, Web of Science published. His research and its impact are truly multidisciplinary and international. He published more than 700 papers indexed in the Web of Science, and his papers belong to 63 different subject categories, starting with automation and control system and electrical and electronic engineering. The citation impact is even more multidisciplinary and is characterized by more than 21,000 citations covering 155 different subject categories. Those citations come from publications of the authors from almost 5,000 universities and research institutions from 122 countries. And he is an exceptionally wide international impact, has extremely high Hirsch index, and not speaking about the same data in other databases, and we have all details because, and thanks to Professor Podlubny, he's world famous expert in geometry, so I could continue with this data quite long, so I skip. Professor Yang Chen is a senior member of IEEE, Distinguished American Institute of Electrical and Electronic Engineering Society, member of American Society of Mechanical Engineers, member of Academy of Model Aeronautics, American Society for Engineering Education, Association of Unmanned Vehicle Systems, in the beginning, and American Water Resources Association, maybe very interesting for also for people from natural sciences in Slovakia. An American Society of Photogrammetry and Remote Sensing, and American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. Professor YangQuan Chen put significant effort in the organization of the work and meetings of the international scientific community. He is a member of the editorial board of more than 10 top refereed journals, and he worked as a member of program committees and scientific committees of numerous international conferences. Among such activities of Professor Chen should be specifically mentioned his role as the chairman of the steering committee of a series of conferences on fractional differentiation and its application, which started in 2004, and a member of the editorial board of the flagship journal Fractional Calculus and Applied Analysis. The number of Professor YangQuan Chen invite plenary keynote lectures difficult to count. Among them, he delivered an unforgettable plenary talk in an international Carpathian control conference in High Tatras, here in Slovakia. In his work and in his approach to life, Professor YangQuan Chen combines the best of the East and West culture. He mentors a large group of graduate students and young researchers of various nationalities, and he is used to host many international events. Ladies and gentlemen, in recognition of the invaluable contribution of Professor YangQuan Chen to the advancement of the world science and engineering, and of his long-term links to the Slovak science and engineering, the scientific board of the Slovak Academy of Sciences has decided to recognize his effort by the International Award of the Slovak Academy of Sciences for the year 2021. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And now I would like to ask the President of the Academy, Professor Pavla Šajgalíka, to present the 2021 International Prize of the Slovak Academy of Sciences and Technical Sciences to Professor YangQuan Chen. I believe flowers will be included as well. And please know that a brand new international prize has been designed by Marian Lašák from the Academy of Fine Arts and Design in Bratislava and produced by the Institute of Materials and Machine Mechanics of the Slovak Academy of Sciences under the supervision of František Simanči, also a member of the presidium. Now, please, open up.
Yes, sir. My honor to be here
Now, as the award has been handed over, I would like to ask Professor Chen to deliver his 2021 International Prize Lecture. Professor, let's get the laptop and look forward to it.
So thank you very much. It was such an honor. So while we are setting up this, let me ask you to think about what Newton was doing in his quarantine times, 1665 and 1666. So in the next 20 minutes, I'm going to share with you my journey about research excellence. In fact, this title of this presentation should be Fraction Order Thinking Leads to Your Research Excellence. Because everybody can do the same if you follow that curiosity and the passion. So I want to thank my wife, Wendy. I want to thank my influencers, like Igor Polovny, Bruce West, and Richard May, and many others. Thank you all for coming. So everything started in 1999. In other words, before 1999, I knew nothing about fractional calculus. So I was working as a hard disk server engineer in Seagate. Seagate is still today one of the two largest hard disk driver manufacturers. Another one is a Western Digit. So there, I read patents regularly. One day I discovered a patent using a TID called Tilt Integral Derivative Controller, where they put this element in there. I do know that S stands for the Laplace symbol for the ddt. So then if I write this way, then I end up with this fractional order. This is a real fractional, one of the n, fractional order derivative. So I was asking myself, what's this? I really want to have a thorough understanding about it. So I asked Google, and Google asked me to ask Ivopolubny, Ivo Petras in 1999. So everything started from there. So Ivo and Ivo told me that this is fractional order derivatives. So then I checked the book, checked the reference, all showed up in 1999. Wonderful year. Both are top-cited, you can see. Today, Polubny's book is considered as the Bible in the field. Especially in chapter 10, will satisfy all your curiosities about what's the use of fractional calculus. There is a very long survey of the applications of fractional calculus. And in control, top journal of IEEE transactions on automatic control published this fractional order PID paper. It's very, very highly cited, impactful. So here's a little bit about my own trajectory. I moved to the US from Singapore in 2000. I spent 12 years in Utah. I got tenure in 2008. In 2002, I started my tenure track. That is, in 2003, I was awarded National Research Council in the United States for a training grant with Slovakia, Technical University of Košice. So that funding got me started so I can arrange trips. I first visited Slovakia in 2005. That's very productive, inspiring, and productive as well. So in 2012, I moved to UC Merced, University of California, Merced, which is the youngest campus in the University of California system. Everybody probably know the University of California, Berkeley, UCLA, UC Santa Cruz, San Diego, and so on and so forth. We're the number 10, started in 2005. So I joined in 2012. So the main reason behind my move is not because of fractional calculus, it's because of the drones. Because I do research on unmanned aircraft systems for precision agriculture. So where California is a big place for agriculture. And then I got started in the tenure track again. Then I got tenured in 14 and 17 as full professor. So if you never heard about in the United States, who wants to get into the tenure track twice? That's way beyond 3 sigma, perhaps 5 sigma. So it's very rare to get into the tenure track twice. I feel proud of this decision. So let's say Slovakia is a big country in fractional calculus related research. Everybody in the field knows that Slovakia is a country that is leading the world on this topic. Everybody knows that visiting Technical University of Košice probably is like looking at the light tower. So lots of people attracted to visiting Technical University of Košice. I visited multiple times, stayed pretty long, like months long, thanks to Professor Igor Podolini. So it has been 23 years I have been benefited from learning from and working with my dear Slovakian friends. There are a lot of activities over the years, cumulatively, we created big impacts to the whole world research community in fractional calculus. For example, we have even created a movement that lots of people will follow the format called Fractional Calculus Day at a certain place, so like XYZ. So there are many, many universities and places they start this type of format, and still widely documented in the website. Have student exchange, join the workshops, special issues, various journals. We publish lots of papers together. Most recently, we even did a MOOC. MOOC stands for a Massive Open Access Courseware, online open courseware. We even had a joint research monograph published on distributed order systems by Springer. So these are all lots of memories. I only pick up just a few. There are some reasons behind it. I want to tell you that this is in a Hollywood, there is a walk of fame. And in the China theater, there are some palm prints. So we took a picture in front of here, Arnold Schwarzenegger. And he has a famous sentence called, "I will be back." So every time when I say goodbye to the eagle, so we'll say, "I'll be back." So today I'll be back again. And this is a very simplest possible dinner we ever had after a long run in Xi'an, in the ancient city of war in the Tang Dynasty. After maybe 16 kilometers running, so we end up with a very, very basic roadside restaurant with very, very basic noodle plus some beer. It's a wonderful memory. And this is also a memory when we visited a very famous site near Kosice with my Technical University of Kosice colleagues. Okay. And so this is Ivo, Professor Petras, when he was young. This is the Professor Ivo Podobny. And Professor Lubomir is also one of the pioneers in using fractional calculus in controls. So today I would like to memorize him. And Jan Terpak did wonderful work as well. So you may wonder, what is fractional calculus? Many of you probably heard about it. I want to give you a very basic introduction to it. Calculus was invented by Newton and Leibniz, you know that. So, but the next slide I'm going to show you, what's the reason behind that? So this one is to tell you the fact that fractional calculus is a differentiation or integration of non-integer order. For example, this blue line is y of x, it's a straight line. If you do first order derivative, you get y equals 1. If you do minus 1's derivative, that is first order integral, then you get a unit parabola. This dancing curve, this green one, is the fraction order derivative of the order between minus 1 to 1, continuously changing. So it is possible to talk about fraction order derivative. So I'll give you some snapshot about the constant half derivative is this one of square root of pi t. Half derivative of t is the square root of t over pi. You see the pattern here. And also t to the power of minus 0.5 is the square root of t, one of the square root of t, and half derivative is exactly zero. So all these looks like not very straightforward. It will become very, very common to you after you studied it for a while. But there are more reasons behind this fractional calculus, why we need it. Because there are cases the integer order calculus will not be able to handle. For example, you have a Weierstrass function. That integer order derivative is nowhere differentiable, but continuous everywhere. However, its fraction order derivative may exist, okay, may exist. So that basically is the beauty of fractional calculus. That can do something we thought we cannot do before. Okay? That's the beauty. And the mathematical definition, I don't want to go through this one, is Riemann Lovell come out with the definition. Basically, it's a fraction order integral, and with integer order derivative later. So it's some sort of convolution structure in here to do a non-local smoothing such that the Weierstrass function will be differentiable again. So that's the basic idea behind fractional calculus. On the other hand, it also carried philosophy of thinking in between. Okay, thinking in between. This is Eastern philosophy, so going in the middle. So why we need to study fractional calculus? I have one slide here. So perhaps we should mention that first, what is the reason we talk about integer order calculus? So people may say, I didn't want to study fractional calculus because it has no impact on my life. This exact same statement applies to integer order calculus. Before the invention of integer calculus, people can still live in good life, right? Even like Newton, Leibniz, before that time, people can only study geometry and algebra, can still have a life, have a good life. But our point here is not just have a good life, right? We want to have a better life, right? So as an engineer, we always want to do better. So fraction order thinking going in between will enable us to do a better job in understanding complex systems, better process those complex signals like heartbeats, our gait, variability, and blood pressure. All those signals are complex signals from a complex system. So we can do a better control of complex systems, better performing optimizations, and better enable creativity. I don't have time to elaborate everything here. I just want you to believe fractional calculus will enable us to do better, to live better. Regarding why we can have a better life with fractional calculus, I want to point you to the book subtitle here. So Complex Worlds, written by Bruce J. West. He basically said that uncertainties, inequalities, and unfairness, they are inherently part of a complex systems that already can be better characterized by using fractional calculus. Okay? So therefore, learning fractional calculus will make you better embrace the complex world. Instead of fighting, you live with it, okay? So that's why I call you can have a better life. I can do more about this part, but I don't have enough time. Basically, let me recap. Why Newton invented integer order calculus? What's the main reason behind it? So I need to mention that 475 BC, okay, Heraclitus already realized that the constant is the change. Okay, so things are always change. So our human always thinking about how to quantify this kind of change for more than 2,000 years until Newton Leibniz invented calculus, such that we can quantify or understand in a quantitative way about the change. So therefore, we can study dynamic models, evolutions, and so on and so forth. So the reason behind integer order calculus is the quantification of change. I hope you get it. But today, what's the reason behind fractional calculus? The key word is the complexity. So we are facing the complex systems. Okay, we are in a complex society. We have a complex world. To better live in it, to better understand it, we must use fractional calculus. So basically, we are here, we can do better, we can do more than ever before. So as an engineer, I usually advocate the saying, do better than the best. Okay. That's the fractional calculus. As you can see, it's not surprising that this area is booming. So in the 1999, it's about 150 papers, until today, like 3797. It's a huge number of increase. It's including the field of science is 208 categories. So it's diffused to almost every subject area in science and engineering, okay? And still developing. I see more and more people getting into the field. I believe this will also benefit some of your research if you start to embrace the thinking of fractional calculus way. So people may ask, we talk about fractional calculus, what and why, and now is when. So when are you going to use it? I already gave you a hint. When things are getting complex, okay? However, this is a bow tie type of thinking. So the real system we are facing is mostly complex, it should be better characterized as a fraction of a dynamic boy. But through the cognitive lens, at the macroscopic level, I constantly use these concepts like skill-free, pivotalness, long-range dependence, long memory, and so on and so forth. But actually, it's related to this IPL that is called inverse power law. So this inverse power law is already talking about fractional characters. It's because of the fractional characters. So at this point, I want to give you a hint about the triangle: fractional characters, inverse power law, and complexity. So these are intimately connected. So fractional calculus, when you see the following words, okay, sorry, then cross media, particulate, anything linked to bio, anything is living, not dead, alive, so then it must be linked to fractional calculus. So I give you an example of the albatross, the birds. The way they seek food, you tap the GPS, check its flight path, it's fractional order randomness. It's called a Levy flight. So it's already fractional calculus here. So I want to further point out that the nature taught the bird fractional calculus such that it can survive better to today. So therefore, please understand Levy flight should be considered as the optimized randomness. After millions of years of evolution for the slow optimization. So towards the future, whether the bird's trajectory of certain food will be more optimized? Answer is yes. We are also in the process. So it is compelling to visit fractional calculus. So in particular, we have both deterministic world and stochastic world. In the randomness, whenever you use the word random or randomness, please consider fractional calculus immediately, because there are so many types of randomness. Many, many types of randomness is because of fractional calculus. And say, just like difference between Brownian motion versus Levy flights, so visually so obvious. But in a PDF sense, it's differences between exponential tail, like this blue curve, Gaussian distribution, or you have a heavy tail, meaning algebraically decaying tail. Likewise, after 3 sigma, you can see the tail here is much thicker, heavier than the exponential tail. So this is called inverse power law, inverse power. This is the root cause that we keep seeing the extreme events. We call it extreme events. We call it anomalous phenomenon. Is exactly because of this heavy tailness here in the fractional order calculus, randomness here. So I hope you get the impression that randomness is important. So this is my last slide, actually. Oh no, almost. So the key message here today is if you want to perform better than the best, you should go fractional calculus, okay? You want to do new science? You should go fractional calculus. Because during that investigation, you will be kind of complexly aware. This is something I'm promoting today for machine learning society. I said, you guys, if you don't put complexity into the context, you are not aware of the complexity, you don't use the information from that complexity, you are not really learning. Also, same thing in the big data. If any of you do machine learning big data related research, please consider fractional calculus and its role. Another important thing can lead to your new science is complexity matching. I like this topic very much. In 2008, there was a 90 pages long science report paper by Bruce J. West to promote this idea of complex matching as a basic principle. So there are many ways you can see complex matching. When I was listening to the quartet, why we feel it's good? Why everybody feels it's good? It's because there's a complex matching in there, okay? So the complexity of music and the complexity in your brain, there's a matching. Okay? There are sometimes you have strong resonance. I think some of you have the experience that after you listen to a music, that music in your brain will circulate for like weeks, long time. You still feel it's there. That's because of the complex matching and the resonance. And this all based on fractional calculus theory. Most recently, Bruce J. Wester convinced me to use the term non-simple, like linear versus non-linear, simple versus non-simple, to replace the word complex. I like it. So go fractional calculus, and then you no longer see anomalous, because anomalous is non. 12 years ago, I was trying to ask the following question. Did Einstein use the wrong calculus? Perhaps yes. So that leads us today, we need to seek the patches from dark matter. Okay? So perhaps dark matter is linked to the use of wrong calculus. Okay? Of course, I'm not educated enough to elaborate more, but I just person the wider guess. So everything I presented so far is my favorite backyard, garden, personal. I love the topic, I nurture it every day, harvest sometimes. But I have front door research. In the interest of time, I just show you briefly about what I do in my front yard, so 2 minutes. So I do drones on many aerosystems for precision ag, environmental monitoring, like sniffing the methane leaks, the permafrost, the soil will have a methane release, quantification of that, and going into the Mayan caves to help to explore the caves. So this subject area is for digital heritage. So of course, mechatronics is my personal bread and butter. I was trying to do controls, but most recently I do smart controls. So I ask to do the control, you usually ask, is this optimal? Is this robust? Now it's time to ask, is this smart enough? How to do that. There are many other topics. I should stop here if you are interested in my front yard research. Ask. Or just Google. Okay. Let's stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the great talk. I do believe that most of us will look up fractional calculus now, and at least on our phones. And I know for myself, and I'm not kidding now, I will actually try to use it for analysis of some data that we have from the neuroscientific data, because that actually seems interesting. Thank you. And now the 2021 part of the award ceremony will conclude with another musical performance. And the Buka Quartet will perform the string quartet in F major, opus 96, nicknamed the American Quartet by Antonin Motard. The Booker Quartet. Thank you.
again, that was the American quartet performed by the Ultra Quartet. And now we shall proceed with the award ceremony for the 2022 International Prize in Natural Sciences. Having received a joint nomination from the University of Veterinary Medicine and Pharmacy in Košice and the Institute of Neuroimmunology of the Institute of the Slovak Academy of Sciences in Bratislava, the Scientific Council of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, in recognition of outstanding work related to Slovakia, awards the 2022 International Prize of the Slovak Academy of Sciences in Natural Sciences to Professor Michel Salzet from the University of Lille. And now a laudation for Professor Michel Salzet will be delivered by myself. Dear Professor, ladies and gentlemen, as usual, this all started about 12 years ago at Smolensk Castle at a conference which was also organized by the Institute of Neuroimmunology and even by some of the people who are actually sitting right now in this very hall. Professor Michel Salzet was not invited to the conference. Professor Isabel Grenier, on the other hand, was invited. I mean, he did show up and he did come anyway, and then he did meet some Slovak scientists who are very interested, but gradually became very interested in his work. And then he became intrigued by theirs. And this turned out to be one of those serendipitous events that led to long-term fruitful collaboration between French and Slovak laboratories, especially between the Institute of Neuroimmunology, the University of Veterinary Medicine and Pharmacy, and the University of Lille. This initial visit has turned to many more visits over the years, and Professor Michel Salzet has developed a strong research and personal bond with Slovak scientific community. The University of Lille is also the alma mater of Michel Salzet. It was there where he received his master's and doctoral degrees and eventually became a distinguished professor at the biology department. Currently, he's the head of PRISM, which I believe stands for the Precision in Medicine Laboratory. And it is an incredibly productive and prosperous one. In fact, it is more like an institute combining work in biology, immunology, neuroscience, proteomics, biophysics, and various analytical approaches with technical applied forward thinking, which together, I have to say, do push the boundaries of science and knowledge. Over his scientific career, Michel Salzet, so far, has published hundreds of scientific papers, and his works have been cited many thousands of times in that fierce competition that is all too well known to all biologists, and I do believe all scientists. The precise numbers are not important, and they do keep growing by the hour, by the way. And then you can trust me, his scientometric parameter values would simply make most of us jealous. As important as such quantitative criteria are, importantly, they are also a reflection of an internationally recognized excellence and brilliance of his research. Such is the research, for example, that represents the mutual cooperation or marriage, if you will, between the immune and neural systems. In fact, this cooperation is also at the very heart of a joint project that started with the serendipitous meeting in Smolenice years ago. This particular research project explores the involvement of immune response in injuries of the spinal cord. After carefully mapping the development of immune response after experimental spinal cord injuries, the team was able to propose the right time window for application of a smart biomaterial drafted with growth factors as potential treatments. As you know, many injuries, if not all, to the spinal cord are not curable at the moment. And this type of research does bring us closer to understanding of a very complex biological process, and perhaps even closer to actual real applications in clinical practice. The important and potentially very useful results were also reflected 2 years ago by Michel Salzet and Dasha Čišková being awarded the Štěpánek Prize, which recognizes outstanding contributions to French-Slovak scientific and technological cooperation. The value of every great scientist can only be magnified by his students. Michel Salzet has also been teaching and mentoring many doctoral students over the years. Several of these students have also graduated in Slovakia as part of a co-tutel agreement between the University of Lille and the University of Veterinary Medicine and Pharmacy. Although I do believe that veterinary pharmacy might also be a thing. All the achievements I mentioned so far are just a small part of his wide range of interests. For example, let me mention a very promising application of immunotherapy in treatment of glioblastoma, which is an extremely unpleasant type of brain tumor, and many others. Today, however, the spotlight is on him, and I believe he will tell something more and very interesting about his work himself. So, before your impending lecture, dear professor, on behalf of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, let me thank you again for your work and dedication, and also for your contribution to the development of excellent scientific collaboration between France and Slovakia, and especially with the duty of liberal science. Thank you. And now, I would like to ask the President of the Academy, Professor Pavla Šajgalíka, to present the 2022 International Prize of the Slovak Academy of Sciences and Natural Sciences to Professor Michel Salzet from the University of Lille. Again, a bouquet of flowers would be included as well. Please. So as the award has been handed over, I would like to ask Professor Salzet to deliver his 2022 International Prize lecture. Professor, the floor is yours.
Good person, and Luis, of course my wife, I hope to say a little bit from me, and Dasha Shiskova, that's Dasha Ideal, and we are very grateful because we have made a lot of work together, and we're still working together for a long time. So, I would like to today to try to walk you about what I called the interactive neuroimmune response, showing you how the nervous system and the immune system are cross-talking using the same language. Now, so nice pictures showing that you get with the COVID, for example. The poor girl is sick. And this demonstrates that the neuroimmune connections. Why? Because if you look about the girl, she has some behaviors, sick behaviors, and the mother takes the temperatures. So this demonstrates that we have some activating immune cells starting to phagocytes and starting to try to have a nice response against the pathogens. So the activity macrophages will release some factors that trigger the brain. And the brain responds by releasing some factors. One factor will be a neurotransmitter. And then we have fevers. Why do we need fevers? Because some bacteria and some viruses are blocked by the temperatures. They are blocking the proliferations. And why do we need a sick behavior? Because when you're sick, the skin dead. So all the energy, and you know that what's growing right now is energy, so energy is only delivered for the immune response. So this demonstrates both communicate. So during my more than 30 years of work, I tried to understand how the evolution and the immune system cross all together. And what is the common language between two systems? And what are the bricks that's used by the both systems and how the systems are operating. Why? Because we want to retrieve about some neuroimmune response, how we can get some clinical approach. So if we started with what you call the nervous system, you have to discuss about neuroendocrine systems. So decades, we think that the central nervous system was the chief of the systems. And with modulating the neuroimmune neuroendocrine system, which after that modulates the immune system. And I show you that's not true. We have productions by the nervous system, some molecules and more the neuroendocrine system, and the father of that is called the So the enterprises tend to do some tactics. I tell you that for example, we have some like neurovedecs, which are winning systems. And this, at the last, we have three unknowns producing these factors. The targets, some coherence, and then after that, we have some impact on the response. But the question is when this occurs, when this crosstalk is happening. For that, we have to go to one of my favorites animal, which is the leech. The leech has this ability to have this nervous system contained directly in blood, secretory glands. And what is produced, all the neuropeptides produced are directly released into the blood. The one molecule which is very interesting is oxytocin. So oxytocin, you know that, everybody knows, because it's used by the mother for trying to have a behavior with this child. It also is a molecule for empathy. So if you have no oxytocin, not that, so that's not good. But we will demonstrate that these animals have the same neuropeptide that we have, exactly the same molecule. So in course of evolutions, starting at the beginning of the story, already there are some molecules that we used by the endocrine system in which as a neuropeptide. And you have two beautiful neurons there that make joints, and they release this, all the factors, into the bloodstream to tackle targeting, for example, the male, female, sex organ. So we can use this animal to inject some pathogens, and you have the nerve cells and you have the ganglia here. So we can inject some pathogen and see what this pathogen can do into the immune response, into the brain. And among several molecules we purified, some antineuropeptides, some substances, we have the ability to fight. We fight one which is related to the precursor, which is called prankephalin. Now, prankephalin is opioids. And opioids, we use this because of stress. We use the opioids during for appetites. We use opioids for learning, for doing now. So for that, we know that's normally localized in the brain. But what we found, it's animal, it's not only in the brain, it's also in human cells. So why we can have some precursor of neuropeptides in human cells? To do what? You also find in DNA of the leeches, for the microglial tubes, and also in the tissue from the epithelium. What we found? We found something interesting. We found that this precursor, which is present in human cells, also found in human amongst, and is cleaved to release these neuropeptides. And some of the neuropeptides activating the immune response, and some sharing some antineuronal activities. They also find some enzyme that have the ability to cleave these precursors to release these neuropeptides, and also find receptors. So, in the immune cells, we have precursor of neuropeptides, we have enzyme to release the peptides, we have also the receptors. So, we have neurons or immune cells. What the difference? Because exactly the same. So, why we have exactly the same mediators produced by immune cells? That's the brain is doing. So, we found this not only in leeches but also in human. And that's just really very interesting because we demonstrate that before the immune response starting, when you do this, I'm starting to release some neuropeptides directly. And I have pain because it hurts, and I release all these factors. And these factors are stimulating the immune response. Antiphamines, for example, all these molecules are triggering the immune response, but also sometimes we need to block the immune response. So the macrophages or the B cells also produce some neuropeptides that block the immune response. So both elements are present in the immune system. We also find some enzyme, and the enzyme are present in lymph nodes, lungs, pineus. So all these elements are present in the immune cells. So we tried to understand if we removed one by one these molecules and what's happening first. This I want to show you because with the COVID, we know some results. It may be very interesting. If we remove the precursor, one is enzyme that has the ability to cleave this precursor of parenchyma, then we look at the mice, it becomes fat fat, a huge thing that animals. And if you look about the immune systems, it's released a huge amount of cytokine. Remember the cytokine storm. So people dying with the cells go through because there is stuff and there is a cytokine storm. These people which have obesity have this enzyme which is cleaved. So one atom, because you have two atoms, you're dying very soon as you can see here. And you have the preventive pressure. And you have another spender. And you have all your macrophages for years. So when you take into characters and you have diabetes, and you're starting to have progress increasing, that's the fact that you have this enzyme chop. So this demonstrates for the first time that when you look about some endocrine enzyme present in the immune cells, they have some impact, but they stay as immune factors. And by that we demonstrate, for example, that this enzyme is involved in regulation, trafficking of some immune system in receptors that we call the innate immune response, the TOR receptors. Without this enzyme, we start to produce a huge amount, without knocking a huge amount of factor which trigger the immune response. If you stimulate after that the immune cells, then you have a huge amount of factor and new macrophages become super macrophages. But that's what we use now to cancer therapy that we are doing with Dasha, because we can get super, super macrophages, and we can use for cell biology and cell therapy is called macrophages therapy. So it's a one way that we are doing this based on the fact that we can remove some neuropeptide precursor or enzyme in macrophages. So what we demonstrate is that if you look about invertebrates and vertebrates for the immune cells, both have already this neuroendocrine system present in immune cells and showing the ability to trigger the immune response or modulate the immune response. And that release a factor that's stimulated for them. So what we found, we demonstrate that we have some neuropeptide which is already present at very soon in evolution, so and we found in vertebrates. So we have some conservation of enzymatic system, geosynthesis, catabolism, and we have demonstrated that this factor is very stable over a long history. We also demonstrate that this peptide appears and before the primitive nervous systems and would serve as intracellular communication before synaptic conditions. And they evolve from a small number of ancestral genes, and demonstrate that these neuropeptides and these precursors already present a synthetized immune system. If you look now on the contrary, can we find some immune factors in the brain to do what? Back to fibroid leech. If you have a leech, then you can easily make some lesions and you make this in steroid conditions where you had some bacteria, life or kill bacteria. And if you look about that, you have some connections, so ganglia and the connective is like the spinal cord for leech. If you make these lesions in steroid, there is no regeneration. But if you do this with bacteria, then start it to repair. So we trigger the immune response and it's helping reparation, the way to repair. And what we found that all receptors demonstrated on the immune systems are already present into the brain. TOR receptors also present. And then once they're activating, they release some anti-hypoglycemic peptides, but they are not anti-hypoglycemic peptides. They are factors stimulating neuric outputs. So it's depending where you think about, when you look about, it's just a way that if you look as a neurobiologist, neuropeptides, you can find now immune cells. If you look about immune cells, immune factors in the brain, did not remain with just factors involved in numerical groups, cognitive behaviors, for example. So now we moved forward what we can find in that way. That's what we've done with Dasha. With Dasha, we developed this model for spinal cord injury, trying to investigate this inflammations. As you can see, the inflammations when you make a lesion, so you inflate the balloon, and you have very fast this inflammation that occurs, and there's a whistle particle and the inflammation gets. So for that, we started to use some molecular technology that we developed in the lab. We developed multi-MSI, multi-mass-spectrometry imaging, and we also do spatial proteomics and spatial imaging. So we go to molecular signatures of what we can see in tangles. So to make some results at 12 hours, one day, 3 days, 7 days, and 10 days, and to see what's happening at the lesion size, roster, and clonal entangles. And what is also secreted, because it's not only into the tissue, but what the factor was secreted during these lesions. To see if we can understand the mechanism that occurs in time course, and the way that can repair, as I show you for each, when you stimulate the immune response, you're triggering the way to repair. With this, we demonstrate that in 3 days, you have some firefighter coming in the Roswell part, so starting to modulate the Roswell, and then starting to make some regenerations. The colon, if you look about the Roswell 2 and colon 2, then you also start into regeneration, and the impact is very important. If you have a car crash, and then you're losing parts of your arm, but you, now we know that a leg can also be repaired. So the clinicians now are looking at this result completely differently, because we know that you can start to repair also the legs, not only taking care about the arm. So we've now found that you can have some tear regulators that stimulate and try to fight the inflammations and producing at the same time some neuric output factors. But there is a discrepancy between in time between the Roswell and the Condor 1. And one tried to find some molecule that can block these regenerations, and we find some immunoglobulins, ROAs, and different factors. The first one was very interesting, and soon, recently, we found it. We demonstrate that even there is no lesions in spinal cord, there is antibodies. Why? We have antibodies in spinal cord, even there is no lesions. And what we found is I find some antibodies, which normally you can find when you make a viral vaccine and you have a second dose. And if we make a lesions, we have some antibodies called IgM appear at 12 hours. Okay? And we find that there is some isotype. So it demonstrates, after that, there is some antibodies coming. So from where they are coming, they're writing. Why we only have some antibodies present in the spinal cord? So we try. We try to find out the source. If the source is not the B cells, the source is not the immune system, it is not astrocytes. Astrocytes produce and neuron produce their own heavy chains of antibodies. The constant part, the immunoglobulins. It's not as we have in directly in B cells, we call that aberrant antibodies. We found exactly the same what you have in cancer cells. In cancer, you have also antibodies. So we try to treat cancer with therapy with antibodies, but they also can do their own antibodies. And when we demonstrate that antibodies act on neurons, because we found also these receptors, and we know that IgG1 like the CD16. And we can bind to the CD16. Then you have your neuronal tools. If you have IgG2, then it's binding to CD32B, and then block regeneration. So this demonstrates that immune factors are involved in regenerations, as we've done in lesions. So we know that we have now to go to the colder one, and we have a target, and with special reworks now to try to make a bridge between the water log to the colder one, and to see how you modulate this immune response and stimulate the repair. So with Mala Cohen, Dasha works on engineers and grafts some boost factors, and he make to use some stem cells, and the stem cells develop neurospheres, and the neurospheres, very interesting, can develop some astrocytes, can develop also after that in neurons on even under the sites, and you can still get them one mass. So we can use these neurospheres and the ejected agenates and feed directly the cavity. And if you feed the cavity, you see that in time course, that you reduce the length of the cavity, you reduce the size of the cavity, and you're starting to have some motor neurons. You're starting to get some synapse, you're starting to get something. It's regenerating. That's the problem that is not go through the complete. So we go back what we found. We found there is ROA inhibitors, we array in it, so we put some ROA inhibitors. We also put some factors which is involved to immune response, and after that we also put some stem cells. Then together we started to have these nice results. As you can see, this one is much better than the other one, and you can start to fill the gap. You fill the gap on the cavity. So if you look the mice, this one, after the lesions, and the mice after the treatment. So this is the beginning of the story. But mice is mice, and dogs are dogs. So Mr. Asha, and Asha make a lot of work on that, and she has some patient dogs, and she started to do the treatment on dogs, and using this treatment, and then to get some results, as you can get, so you can see now for 1 month with the dog. So we are moving in good directions. So what I show you today, we have some immune factors which are produced by the brain, associated microglial neurons. They are involved in neurogenesis, neurological growth. We also find some immunoglobulins produced. We have, I call that the ADNM responsive. It's an antibody dependent neurotoproduce response. And we demonstrate that what we thought at the beginning, there is no shift between the immune system and the brain. No one is trying to be the leaders. Both are working together. We have some immune cells producing some neuroendocrine mediators, and all these factors are involved in immune response. We have immune factors produced by the brain, all are involved in neurogenesis or connective memory. And between there is some crosstalk regulation, because they have exactly the same words, the same messages for the immune. And where we are now moving, and we would like to go, it's the fact that we have some immune response with memory, and we know that immune memory is based with antibodies. It's based with apoptotic epitopes, so we know that we have a huge amount of diversity. And now we found the same in the brain. Can our memory be as antigens with paracels? But it's not antigen, it's some molecules that you remember, for example, Proust and Pink. How this can be used by our system to know when you associate this cake from your grandmother, when you're swinging this, it's coming back. And perhaps we like to go to that direction. That's why it will be the antigens will feed the cake, and the parabolic will be out to bring this. It's a way that we would like to go. Let's see if that's always good or not. So just to show you in the finish, I can say that both systems like Janus, two wanted looking after doors. And this is interesting to see that both using the same language. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. The video is very incredible. I do hope that not too distant future, maybe even us, will have the pleasure of experiencing the results in clinical practice. And now the 2022 part of the award ceremony will conclude with another beautiful performance by the Mucha Quartet, who will perform the very lightweight and rhythmic part of the string quartet in F major by the Mucha Quartet. Thank you.
Thank you. And now we're coming to the conclusion of the award ceremony. And on behalf of the President of the Slovak Academy of Sciences, Professor Pavla Šajgalíka, I would like to extend thanks to all of you for coming and attending the award ceremony, especially to the artists for their marvelous performances, and especially, again, to both award recipients. After the ceremony, please accept our invitation to a reception that will be held downstairs at the mezzanine. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for coming. And now please rise for the procession of the Slovak Academy of Sciences.